Everybody has that lack of welders today, and I think a cobot really can help them fill those needs. To be able to access parts anywhere in the work zone.
Hey Jamie, it's good to see you. It's been a while since we got a chance to catch up. We've got the ESAB Extended Reach Cobot here.
Pretty exciting.
It is. You know, it opens up a whole lot of other opportunities, but what are some of those things that you're seeing your customers, what are the challenges that they're facing these days?
Well, every facility that I've been to is the lack of welders, trained welders, capable welders. The difficulty retaining the welders is probably their biggest challenge. Everybody has that lack of welders today, and I think a cobot really can help them fill those needs.
Yeah, and good thing is that the demand hasn't gone away, just the welders have seemed to go away.
You know, and you know, a few years back, the AWS put out a study that the average age was 55. I'm almost 55 now, and I don't think I'd want to be welding every day from start to finish on some of these smaller monotonous parts where, you know, you got a low volume, but a high mix, and this, I think, really fills that need.
With the extended reach, I've noticed people are implementing cobots a little bit different. I mean, this is a great size table, and I see the table. What are some of the other things they're doing?
Well, you know, when you got the bigger size table, you can also divide it into zones. The one particular customer that I have had a smaller, had the UR10, our first launch, on the small table, small environment. He ended up on the 5x10, he put it in the middle, and it allowed him the flexibility to have both sides. This one here, I mean, you talk about reach. Look, I'm here, out of this corner, I can be out of this corner. Tremendous reach compared to the 10. I think it's a little over 14 inches longer to be able to access parts anywhere in the work zone.
And still just as easy to move around, I can see.
Well, you know, that's the biggest thing that everybody tells me is the ease of use, ease of motion. It doesn't freeze up, it doesn't lock up. So this free drive button really gives us the flexibility to move it around and get it into precise location wherever we want to teach the test point.
And how about if I have a 10, a smaller unit, and I bring this into the family, do I have to learn new software?
It's exactly the same.
And everything
the benefit,
the same.
You know, in here, you would just add, you would see here that we have multiple robots in the robot section. We have two different ones. I would just add a third robot so the operator could choose between whichever robot he was running that day. And what that does is allows us to have part history. So if anybody makes any changes, we know exactly who made the changes.
And it's still back to the same old adage. If you can use a welder, you can use a phone.
Absolutely. I mean, if you were to give a welder the robot teach pennant and ask him to know the coordinate system, he kind of stands back and goes, hey, wait a second. But you reach in your back pocket and you give him the phone, you say, hey, I got the app on my phone. You can run it from there. It's a lot more flexible, a lot easier to use.
I like that. I'm glad we stuck with that. What should a customer who's thinking about automating and stepping into the cobot world or robotics, what should they think about? What should they consider?
Well, you know, considering the different kind of parts they make, they don't necessarily have to have high volume. They can have lower volume. I had a customer that, you know, made 10 of these, 10 of those, but what it allows them to do is the product consistency. From the first one to the last one, they're exactly the same. And that's the benefit of using a cobot to do that. You don't really affect the welding environment. Operators or the welders are now adapting to this because they see that if you can make more parts faster, the customer or the fabricator can generate more business, can stay in business longer. So I think the welders are not feeling like this is a replacement for them. It's just adding to the benefit.
Helping them stay off the floor a little bit, helping them stay out of those hard to reach places.
Helping them stay out of the fumes as well, right?
Oh,
you don't
yeah.
have to, it's here. You know, for ease of use, we talked about the parts and the playlists. If I go to the parts and if I want to create a part, I just add it. And here I can call it, let's call it fillet, for example. And at this point, if I go next, what it will do, it'll go to a predetermined library that I generate as the user when I'm using this. So in this case here, we just have one here set up for demo, but I can either go in and manually enter the weld settings. I can choose the conditions, whether I want to be pulse or CV, whether it's steel, aluminum, or stainless steel. I can choose the type of gas. And here's where I would enter the welding conditions. Now, when I start with this, this allows me to do a generic weld condition for the entire part. But I can go into each section that I've taught and change those welding parameters independently. So I'm not locked into one parameter for the entire part. What I'll do here is I'm just gonna go back and pick the generic one. And what it does is opens up the programming library that allows me to use the robot to teach the part. I can teach a linear weld, I can do a radial weld, which I will use here to show you a circle. A tack weld, if I had parts in a fixture and I wanted to tack them up prior to welding them so that they don't move and I keep everything in place. A linear stitch weld, if I pick point A and point B, say that I want three welds an inch long, it'll automatically calculate it. Rotary, if I, in this table, you could have different zones, and one zone could be a rotary position where I just activate it to do flanges on
you
pipes.
You mean tooling?
Tooling,
wow.
Absolutely, yeah.
Okay.
So in this case, we'll just do a straight linear weld. You'll notice that I'll put the tablet down. The bottom is flashing, so it's in teach mode. I'm not programming a robot, I'm teaching it. So once I activate the free drive button here, I can rotate the torch into position. While holding it, I can get into position. What I do is I press the button, I teach the first point. I get it to the next point, not really caring how I get there, just knowing that that is the next point. I push the button. If I bring it out and I want a clear tooling, I push and hold it. It'll transfer over an air move. I just record it. I can save it. It's going to ask me, do I want to add it to an existing playlist or do I want to create a new one? In this case, I want to create a new one. And at that point, the operator would come to the button box. And you notice, I don't use the tablet to start the robot. Safety is you use the pendant. So now I would just use the button box. It'll come down. And it'll weld the path that I just taught it.
And I could take that from here and take it right over there to the smaller one and do the exact same procedure. It's already done.
From an operation standpoint, the operator wouldn't know the difference between the UR20 or the UR10E. No difference from an application standpoint.
So if I have two and I usually weld this part on this one and that day this one's all busy, I just say, okay, we're gonna weld it on the other guy today. No problem.
Absolutely, no issue.
So I've noticed some of the customers have also been wanting or taking the larger reach and they're pushing it up to their part. We have a mobile version and they're welding much, much larger parts. It's not, we put a table up so you can simulate the small stuff, but the same cobot can go 10 feet high.
Oh, absolutely. If you have a structural member, you want to go in and put some stiffeners, you can come in and teach the points, have it do it, roll it around to different positions. It's probably a little more difficult on this one, but the benefit with this is I have the longer reach cobot to be able to do that.
So what would you say is the ideal customer? Where do these fit in today's industry?
Anybody that welds.
Anybody
that welds. I have a customer that's welding little displays for storefronts, shelving units, the little cell phone holder racks that they make. I have another guy that does railings, structural members for concrete castings. It really doesn't matter. As long as they got a part to weld, I think we can help them out.
I think especially the extended reach, I've got a customer who uses or welds on tractor parts. Another one works on tractor implements. Another guy, kind of the same thing. He works on duct work, welded ducts, and his stuff's real small. And he made the decision to go with the large one. He says, I don't know what I'm doing tomorrow. So
exactly,
he got it today.
Exactly. The longer one does give you greater reach, more capacity. The availability of these products. Standard traditional robot cells are what? 8, 10, 12 months delivery. Implementation is a month. Training is a couple extra weeks.
If you're lucky.
These units are stocked. A couple week delivery time. Training is probably a day. Setup is only about an hour to 2 hours, and they're up and running. Traditional, you would be months before you could get it up and running. So very quick turnaround to get into production.
Yeah, it's a good thing you mentioned that. You mentioned earlier that this solves the labor problem. This solves a quality problem. This solves a capacity problem. And it solves those problems now.
Now.
Not in 6 months.
Exactly.
Today.
Exactly.